Okay. So, good morning to everybody. It's my pleasure to meet you all via this webinar, and thank you, Dr. Parasuram, for inviting me for this. So today I would like to go over with one of our important research that we are going on so far, which is the artificial intelligence and graph modeling approach that we used recently to find out the drug targets in Alzheimer's drug discovery. So to begin with, I would like to give a brief introduction about this Alzheimer's disease and what made us to really look into this graph modeling and the AI-based techniques to find out the drug discovery. So, it's an age-dependent neurodegenerative diseases, which includes that Alzheimer's, Parkinson, and Huntington's. So all these neurodegenerative diseases pose a major health problems, like which includes a severe memory impairment, speech loss, and movement disorders. It is estimated that more than 24 million people have been diagnosed with AD worldwide. And the cost for the caregivers is kept on increasing, and it's almost a quarter of a trillion. So that tells us that how major economic burden this Alzheimer's disease is posing on us. And so this neurodegenerative diseases in general, they are all marked with characteristic protein aggregates in the brain tissue. So these diseases, how we are distinguishing is based on the presence of specific seed proteins. We call a seed protein in the sense that initiates this aggregation. So for example, this Alzheimer's disease is characterized by extraneuronal A-beta 42 amyloid containing plaque, and then the hyperphosphorylated tau, which are all intracellular that forms a tangle. So the picture that we are seeing here is the classic example of a plaque and a neurofibrillary tangles from the affected human brain sections. In 2017, up until 2017, we are not sure how this plaque and tangles looks like. And thanks to the cryo-electron microscopy discovery that two separate group in the same year have published the work on how the A-beta plaque look like. For example, in the picture that we are seeing here is containing the fibrils of A-beta 42 peptides, a stack of peptides. And the second figure that we are seeing here is again derived from cryo-electron microscopy that consists of hyperphosphorylated tau tangles. So this discovery gave us a lot of insights into how the molecular arrangement of this plaque and hyperphosphorylated tangles looks like. Although we know how this, we know the seed proteins and how this plaque looks like and the tangles looks like, still the mechanism behind this aggregate initiation and progression remains to be answered. Although there are a few lead candidates that are right now in the clinical trials, there is no promising drugs for treating these neurological disorders, especially this Alzheimer's. The aggregates that the protein aggregates initially were thought to be containing only the seed proteins, which is, for example, A beta 42 and hyperphosphorylated tau in case of Alzheimer's, or polyglutamate 40 in case of Huntington's. But later on, with the proteomics and the other approaches, we could able to identify a lot of other proteins in that particular aggregates. For example, ubiquitinated alpha synuclein 1433 and various phosphorylated TDP 43. So these proteins were found in a lot of aggregates, regardless of the neurodegenerative disease. For example, in Alzheimer's or Parkinson's or Huntington's, we could able to find these proteins in that aggregates. So based on these evidences, we started our strategy. We wanted to isolate the or purify these aggregates and then identify their protein components. So what are all the proteins that are present in either the A-beta plaque or tau? Once we know what these protein components are, then it would be easy for us to identify their functional roles. Like how much is the influence of these proteins in the aggregate progression. So once we know this protein components, then the next question that we can ask is, what would be the aggregate specific protein-protein interactions are happening inside? So if your proteins are there, then how well they are interacting with the seed protein? Identifying that would be very important to understand how the aggregate stability is happening and how this progression goes, because it's an age-dependent neurodegeneration, so it prolongs for more than 10 to 20 years, the aggregation events will happen. So once we know this protein-protein interactions, then we can easily identify novel new therapeutic targets for preventing reducing the protein aggregation in the neurodegenerative diseases. So based on that, so we have to start with the model system. So we started with C. elegans as a model system. So there are a lot of benefits in studying C. elegans as a model system, because a lot of genes and pathways are shared between human and C. elegans. So any perturbation that we are making in the C. elegans, it can be translated directly into human. Plus, since these are all the age-dependent protein aggregation, we can nicely, C. elegans lives, the median lifespan of C. elegans is about 17 days. So it's not like mouse model. We have to wait like 2 years or 3 years to see the effect. This is like in 17 days, we can able to nicely see the age-dependent protein aggregation and whatever the perturbation that we are making, we can nicely do it. So that's the second important point in using C. elegans. And another nice thing about using C. elegans as a model system is to knock down specific genes. If we want to know their functional roles, it is very simple doing the knockdowns in C. elegans. And also, the picture that you are seeing here is the model for Huntington's. So it's all the Q40, the polyglutamate aggregates that are fused with the green fluorescent protein. So we can nicely visualize in the fluorescent microscope for the presence of this puncta aggregates throughout the body of the C. elegans. So we first started with this C. elegans, the simple model system, to see what proteins are getting recruited into this seed aggregates. So when Dr. Ayadevra did his proteomics on this C. elegans Huntington's model, we can able to see that a lot of proteins apart from Q40 are getting into the aggregates at day 5. And in the day 7, when the age progress, we can able to see the recruitment of new proteins into the aggregates. And between day 5 and day 7, we can clearly see there is a decline in the movement of the C. elegans, which is clearly depicting the toxicity of this aggregates. So like I said before, using C. elegans, it is very simple to do the knockdown and to directly assess the functional roles of the C. elegans. So we did the knockdowns of many of these proteins, and we could able to see protection from a lot of these proteins. When we knock down this gene, we can able to see less amount of aggregates. And one particular protein, which we named that as CRAM1 because it was previously undiscovered. So that protein, we named it as CRAM1. So when we knock down this particular protein in several model system, it can be Huntington's or it can be Alzheimer's or Parkinson's model, we could able to see protection against aggregation if we knock down this protein. That clearly indicates that there is a leveraged role played by this CRAM1 protein in the aggregate progression. So when we did the two-dimensional gel to really see the distribution of this aggregation, so this is the control day 5 worms that the aggregates that we can able to see there is a recruitment of insoluble aggregates here. But when we knock down this protein, we can able to see a significant protection against that aggregates, which clearly indicates that this protein is playing a very crucial role in the protein aggregation. So like I said, any protein or any functional perturbation that we are making in C. elegans, it can be translated to human. So the CRAM1 has a human ortholog, which is called SERF2, which is a small EDKR-rich protein. So when we knock down this protein in human cell culture model of AD, in which where we can find the protein aggregates based, the amyloid-like aggregates based on thioflavin T positive staining, we could able to see a significant protection against the aggregate when we knock down this protein. So these results, I would like to, based on these results, I would like to imply that not just the seed proteins, so there are common proteins that could play a very crucial role in the aggregate progression and the stability in these neurodegenerative diseases. And that tells us that we need to study a lot about these common proteins and how they interact with this seed proteins. So based on that preliminary evidence, then we went to the direct proteomics of human AD brain samples from our brain bank. So when we did the proteomics of that, whether it is a plaque or it's a neurofibrillary tangles, these are all purified aggregates, like based on the immunopurification, based on antibody against A-beta 42 or tau. So we've been able to see a variety of aggregate pattern in the gel. So, and then we sent this to proteomics and we identified the specific protein contents from the plaque or from the neurofibrillary tangles. And we could able to identify at least 600 to 700 high confidence proteins in our aggregate proteomics. So again, we went back to the C. elegans because these proteins are novel proteins that we identified from human proteomics. So we wanted to see how many of those protein really plays a major role in the protein aggregation. So based on the spectral hits at this point, we selected the top candidates. So it's not a random knockdown. So we selected the top candidates based on the spectral hits. And then we did the knockdown series of knockdown in the C. elegans. So we can able to see some of the proteins are showing significant protection from chemotaxis, which is the behavioral protection from C. elegans, in the C. elegans. So as a short summary to what I would like to go further, which is like using a proteomics approach, we identified many protein constituents from AD brain aggregates, which were previously unknown, apart from the seed proteins, which is A-beta 42 or hyperphosphorylated tau. And when we knock down many of these proteins that are high abundant proteins in the brain aggregates, in C. elegans, we could able to see protection in multiple neurodegenerative model systems, whether it is AD or Parkinson's or Huntington's. And very interestingly, when we did the proteomics of other neurodegenerative disease, for example, Parkinson's or Huntington's, we could able to identify many of the proteins that are commonly present in a variety of aggregates and also in different individuals. So that clearly tells us that some of these proteins that we are seeing in the aggregates is not random. So it's not going there like a random chance. So there is some ordered pattern that is going on that is recruiting these proteins into the aggregate to make it as a massive insoluble aggregates. So, and we would like to understand how this aggregate overall looks like. So then this is where I asked a question like, then how does this massive insoluble aggregate looks like? So for that, we need to really define an aggregate interactome. So this aggregate specific interactome is not like a functional interactome that we are seeing in cake pathways like that. So we need to purify this aggregate first, and then we have to make a way to really find out what these proteins are and how they are interacting to each other. This is a little tricky method because these proteins are not evolved to interact to each other, but somehow they are entering into the aggregates and then making a new interaction. So that's what we wanted to find out, what are their interacting partners. So defining that kind of aggregate specific interactome or a contactome will help us understanding the overall aggregate architecture in these neurodegenerative diseases. And based on that, we can develop a lot of protein-protein interaction inhibitors or general protein inhibitors to prevent this aggregate formation. So for this, we have used the we have used this interdisciplinary approach or multifaceted approach. So we wanted to have this experimental models, and from that, we derive a computational modeling or simulations. And at the same time, we used the bioinformatics and graph modeling approach to identify this aggregate interactome. So we used all these technologies to really find out what is this aggregate interactome is. So in general, this is the overall protocol or procedure that we used to achieve our goals. So first, like I said, from any model system, whether it can be a human brain directly from human brain samples or if it is from any other cell culture model system. So we are purifying the aggregates first, like in sarcosyl insoluble purified aggregates. And once we have the purified aggregates, then we are cross-linking the aggregate. So we used from the Chaudhary et al. Publication that came in 2017, I believe. So we modified the click reagent. So the click reagent is nothing but we use two type of crosslinker. The first crosslinker will have a azido group that goes and binds to the protein of our interest or protein-protein interaction of our interest. And then based on the biotin, we will pull down that protein-protein interaction pairs. So then we will be doing the triptic digestion. So the strategy here is if a protein and protein or if two peptides are interacting together, then the triptic digestion will cleave off all other parts of the protein other than the two interacting peptides. So once that peptide goes into the mass spectrometry, then we can able to identify based on the interacting fingerprints that these two peptides were interacting in the aggregates. So once we know that information, then we can use that information into the graph modeling packages, and we can model the overall graph, how this aggregate interactome looks. So from that graph modeling, we can then generate a lot of descriptors. The descriptors, for example, clustering coefficient or eigenvector centrality or the hub proteins or many graph theoretical modeling we can use. So those descriptors, we can have it as our starting material for analyzing our influential proteins. So then based on the graph modeling, we will know that what are all the hub proteins or hub connectors, which I will come to you in later slides. So we will know what are all the important proteins present in the graph or the interactome, and we can directly test their influence in aggregates in our C. elegans models or cell culture model. So based on both the graph descriptors as well as the knockdowns that we are doing, we can use both of them into the neural network and machine learning. Because practically, we found more than 600 proteins in the aggregates. And when I did the cross-linking, I got close to 7,000 protein-protein interactions, high confidence protein-protein interactions in the model system. So practically, we cannot knock down all the protein, or we don't know how many of those proteins are actually influencing these aggregates. So this is where we used our neural network and artificial intelligence approach to really predict what would be the influential protein that really plays a leveraged role in aggregate growth or instability. So to devise our cross-linking protocol, we used a simple model system. Because AD proteomics would be very complex and messy to really play around with any protocol. So we used a simple model system, which is the human cell culture having the familial Swedish mutant APP that forms amyloid-like aggregates. So the picture that we are seeing here that has a dots here, that is all thioflavin-positive amyloid-like aggregates. So we used this model system, and then we collected those aggregates. And then we did the sarcosyl insoluble. Sarcosyl is nothing but a harsh detergent. So these insoluble aggregates, the name insoluble matters that even in the 1% harsh detergent, these aggregates are insoluble. So we used that technique to really collect and purify that insoluble aggregates from the ultracentrifugation technique. So once we have that insoluble aggregates, then we used our chemical crosslinker that I explained to you before. The modified click reagent. So that goes and binds to a protein-protein peptide pair. And then we did the triptic digestion, and then we did the mass spectrometry to identify that protein-protein or peptide-peptide pairs from the insoluble aggregates. So then that raw data were fed into the graph modeling software package to construct the aggregate interactome for this model system. So once we have that aggregate interactome, then we can do the functional testing of the protein interactions in C. elegans or in cell cultures. So for graph modeling, I used this GIFI software. So that has an ingrained statistical package as well. So that calculates a lot of descriptors for you, like eigenvector centrality or closeness or betweenness. So those are all very crucial graph theoretical models or graph descriptors to predict what would be the influence of our protein node. So the node here means I'm telling about each protein in the aggregate. So in order to develop, in order to avoid any false positive protein-protein interaction, so we set our threshold to really a high stringent method. So we imposed two main categories here, which is each peptide-peptide pair that we are seeing in the cross-linking, it has to have minimum 10 spectral hits or more. So normally we go with 3 spectral hits or maybe 4 or 5 spectral hits when in a general proteomics, but we wanted to set our threshold to really high extent. So we set 10 spectral hits or more, and then that particular peptide-peptide interaction should be present in 3 or more individual samples. So which means like if that particular interaction is present in all the 3 different individual aggregate preparation, then it might not be false positive. At least we would say 80 to 90% might not be a false positive. So we used that criteria and we modeled the graph, the aggregate interactome, aggregate specific interactome for the model system. So the graph here we are seeing is the really a messy protein-protein interacting network of this SY5Y-ABP system. And the green lines that we are seeing here are the unique interaction present only in the SY5Y-ABP Swedish mutant. So which means these particular interactions, like I told you, around 7,000 interactions are very specific for this amyloid-like aggregates, or disease-specific, we can call in other words. So before going into the hub-protein or any other graph terminology, I would like to give a small introduction, what we call as hub and what we call as hub-connector. So a protein that is interacting to many partners, let's say more than 10 or 20 partners, we call as hub protein. So it can be 100 or it can be 20, whatever, depending on the number of interacting partners, which we call degrees, we can separate them, we can classify them based on the hub sizes. And then there is another interesting category of this protein interaction or the node we call, which is a hub connector. So which means in the picture that we are seeing here, there are 3 major hub, I would say a big hub protein, but they are not directly connected to each other unless if you have this hub connector in between. So this hub connector is really playing a connecting role or making a stability. This is what giving most of the stability in connecting these separate hubs. So that's another interesting category of node in the interactome to be, it's a notable protein. So based on the criteria, we have in the SY5Y-ABP system, we have these many categories like mega hubs, like around 3.3% of the proteins are having more than 100 interacting partners. And the major hub we have, and then the mini hub up to the hub connectors. So how we classify this hub connector means we use the clustering coefficient and eigenvector centrality, and then it has to be around 2 to 9 interacting partners, but should connect a major hub or mega hub, which are otherwise not connected. So that's what we call it as hub connector. So in that category, we have 26% of the proteins. So then we wanted to go into the in-depth analysis of identified contactome. So what we can make out of this identified interactome? So first we begin with our seed protein. So since this is an ABP model system, we wanted to see what are all the interacting partners of this this ABP protein, or otherwise we call this as this E2 domain. And the picture here we are seeing, the circled region is where actually the Swedish mutant is there. and that is the peptide, or that is the region that we are we seen a lot in the aggregates. So we could able to see how they are directly interacting to other important proteins in the category. And the red dot here means they are the major hub and having more than 100 interacting partners. So this gave us a lot of insights into how this APP protein, a seed protein, really growing into a massive aggregates based on other interacting partners. So then I wanted to confirm whether the identified protein-protein interaction is making any biological sense. So I used the computational docking and simulation approach, the molecular dynamics simulation approach. So that this is a crystal structure of SRRM2 RNA binding protein, and this is the E2 domain of this APP protein. So then I did this protein-protein docking and the simulation, and it predicts where the circled region here we are seeing is the predicted, computationally predicted protein-protein interaction region. And very interestingly, when I went back to the peptide-peptide interacting pairs that we got from the cross-linking, this is the same peptide that we are seeing from the click chemistry. So that is again, is that is the same for top one and also for the ABP-E2 interaction. So this gave us confidence that the click chemistry-based approach that we are using is giving some meaningful interactions to pursue further. So again, we went back to the C. elegans system because now this is all the proteins that we got from human brain samples. So we wanted to see, are there any functional roles of these proteins identified in the C. elegans model system? So again, we use the C. elegans AD models, which where the A beta 42 is being presented in the neurons. So what will happen is,
I'm like, here net disconnected.
Hello. Yeah. So so this will give us the basic insights about the toxicity of this protein aggregation. So when we did the knockdown of proteins, like so in this case we chose random proteins. For example, we selected a bunch of mega hubs and bunch of major hubs, and we wanted to go wide across the, all the hub categories and see what are all the protective roles. And we can able to see most of the some of the candidates that are really protective in each hub categories. So but the question here is, we have, like I said, we have more than 600 protein nodes in the interactome and 7,000 interacting pairs. So practically, we cannot really knock down all these proteins and see what are all playing a significant role and a druggable target. So this is where we need some method to really understand what would be the highly influential proteins in that particular contact zone. So we have to use this graph modeling plus the neural network to train, and we asked whether it can able to predict us whether the like what proteins could be influential. So these are all the descriptors we got from the GFI graph modeling, like degree, which means that the number of interacting pairs, and degree centrality. So how well that interacting pairs are present in the aggregate interactome, is it really present internally in the aggregates or superficially? And the number of triangles means how well each protein interactions are again connected to other proteins. And then the clustering coefficient. So we have a lot of these descriptors to go with. So like this is an example of how we got this this protein degrees or the descriptors. So we found totally we got around 13 descriptors from this graph modeling approach. But we don't want to use all the 13 descriptors in the neural network because we don't know how many of them will be a dependent variable. So we wanted to remove all the dependent variables from the 13 descriptors. For example, the number of triangles and the triangle coefficient and all those would be dependent. So we wanted to remove those from our neural network search. So for that, we have used our PCA and multivariate regression analysis. And then we can able to bring what would be the independent variables in that. So the endpoint here, what we used is what is interesting. How we are going to say that this protein is influential or not? So we wanted to use our knockdowns. So when I did a random knockdown of all these different hub categories, I can able to see some of them are protective, some of them are not protective, and some of them doesn't have any change at all. So that is a classic example for a training set. So we wanted to use that protective efficacy. For example, when you knock down the gene, what is the protection? So that is directly proportional to the amount of aggregates present in the model system. So we wanted to use that as an endpoint here or a dependent variable there. So with all these descriptors, we asked the question, using all these graph descriptors, can our neural network model predict the experimental values? So we can clearly see here the experimental values versus the predicted value matched very well, and we are getting the R square of 0.85. So that gave us a confidence that based on this graph modeling and also including our wet lab knockdown efficacy, we can able to predict what proteins could be highly influential. So for example, if you can see here the EIF3A, it says 2.1, which means 2.1 fold protection from the aggregates. So like that, we will be generating for the entire aggregate interactome, what would be the fold change when we knock down that protein. So that will, that is directly implying the influence of the protein. So based on that training, so this is, for example, the predicted versus the experimental. So all matched very well with our with predicted versus the neural network prediction with experimental. So for using the neural network, we use this orange package, so which is a very interesting and user-friendly package. And so we have to, they have their own protocol for doing the neural network and testing and scoring algorithms. So we use this orange package to do the neural network modeling. So like I said, so we used the contactome or the interactome based descriptors and the experimentally known knockdown results for a general, for the like a random knockdowns from the aggregates. And that was sent into the machine learning approach. And then now here, the graph that we are seeing here is the predicted neural network based efficacies. So really the big nodes here we are seeing, they are the hub proteins, they are the major hub. And the color here mentions that more than threefold protections when you knock down the particular protein. So clearly we can see a lot of proteins inside this aggregates, they are playing a highly influential role. And that is showing that when you knock down that protein, you are taking away threefold to fourfold aggregates. So that directly implies a novel drug targets. So now we have generated this aggregate-based interactomes. So now also we know what are all the influential proteins, and also we know what are all the hub proteins and what are all the hub connectors. So now what I wanted to do is, can it directly translate into a therapeutic value? So that's the major goal. So we can use two types of drug discovery strategy in this. So first strategy would be, you have a big protein or a big hub, a mega hub, for example. You can target this protein and put an inhibitor for that. So that will take away the whole bunch of aggregates from the interactome. So that is the one strategy. But there is one problem with that strategy is, since that particular hub protein is connected with a lot of other proteins, it is very hard for a drug to really go and bind to the target site that we are predicting. So we can still use that, but it's a little a tough strategy to go with. But there is another drug discovery strategy which I'm interested in doing. This is like, instead of really targeting a major hub, we can target this hub connectors. So because this hub connector is for holding many hub proteins together. So once we remove that, then these hub proteins are isolated in that aggregate, which we can, which are autophagy, you can treat it with an autophagy enhancers or proteasome enhancers. So that would really clear off this bunch of aggregates. So now to test this hypothesis, can hub connector be a drug target? We took, based on the neural network, or whatever we predicted, the hub connectors, showing a significant protection, we chose some of the top candidates predicted by the artificial intelligence approach. So when we knock down those proteins separately in our C. elegans model system, and we can able to see some of the proteins are really showing a huge protection, which is similar to what the neural network has predicted in protecting against the aggregation. So this tells us that the targeting hub connector can be an interesting strategy or alternate strategy to do the drug discovery in Alzheimer's. So if you remember in the previous slides, I talked about the SURF2, which we found in the C. elegans, and then their human ortholog. Interestingly, that same SURF2 is also present in the AD aggregates as the hub connector, and our neural network predicted that this SURF2 can be a influential protein in the aggregate progression or the stability. So since we've done a lot with that SURF2, I wanted to go further to test whether can we put a drug towards that protein-protein interaction pairs. Because from the protein-protein interactome, what we learned is which region of the SURF2 is interacting to other protein. So for example, the SURF2 connects to 6 crucial major hubs. This SURF2 is a highly disordered protein. So to really understand how this interacts, so we did like a microsecond scale molecular dynamics, and the video that we are seeing here, it clearly shows how this peptide unwinds. So this protein is highly disordered, and it unwinds at a rapid rate. And this is the region where the unwinding region you can clearly see in the green. So that's what we found a lot in our protein-protein interactome. So that goes and binds with a lot of the 6 crucial major hub, major proteins, and then playing a role as a hub connector. So then I asked the question whether can we use this protein-protein interactome or the protein-protein interactions that I predicted using computational modeling, can I put a drug there? So I used a structure-based drug discovery approach, and I screened the Cambridge compound library, which has like 735,000 druggable compound, virtual compounds. So I used that library and screened against that particular site, which we found that SURF2 is interacting to other proteins. So we got some from the top candidates when I did the wet lab testing. We found two of the top candidates is highly protective or highly significant in protecting against this thioflavin aggregates. And this is what we are right now working on a patent rights for this drug. And this MSR001 or 002, it's showing a protection against multiple model systems for in C. elegans as well as in Huntington's models or in Parkinson's model as well. So based on the interactome, so the key findings from this approach, what we have got here is like, so the aggregates of several neurodegenerative disease consist of many proteins other than seed proteins. So this is what I would like to give as a take-home message, not just A-beta or not just hyperphosphorylated tau. So although these seed proteins, A-beta 42 or tau, is crucial, or these are all the initiating seed proteins for the aggregation, but at later stages, they recruit many proteins, and those many proteins that they recruit plays a very crucial role in maintaining the aggregate stability and further growth of the aggregates. And most of these proteins that we are seeing in the aggregates are highly disordered and misfolded, or they are post-translationally modified. For example, phosphorylated, or we even found a lot of oxidized proteins in the aggregates. So these post-translational modification can lead to a structural change, and that structural change could lead to expose this hidden hydrophobic region that plays that participate in protein-protein interaction in the aggregate formation, in the aggregate growth. And then knockdown of many of these common proteins that we found showed a significant protection against aggregation. So this clearly tells us that apart from A-beta 42 or tau or glutamine 40 or alpha-synuclein, these other common proteins also play a very crucial role in the aggregate stability. So in summary, in this work, we have defined for the first time the protein-protein interaction network that are specific for insoluble aggregates formed in the model of Alzheimer's. And right now we also have, and we are working on a paper that the total human interactome. So that's, we found almost close to 15,000 to 20,000 high confidence protein-protein interaction pairs. So now we are trying to elucidate the influential proteins from the human interactome that we got. And comparing these interactomes with the wild type or with wild type on the diseased condition, we can able to clearly predict what would be the aggregate specific or A beta specific aggregates, or in other words, we can call a disease specific interactions. And then when we did the preliminary screening of this protein-protein interaction inhibitors, we got some good lead compounds to pursue further to get more potent compounds against this aggregate, protect against this aggregation. So defining this aggregate architecture or this protein-protein interaction pairs definitely will bring a lot of this novel targets that we can use for therapeutics. And I've given the paper that is from 2019 in my name. So we have given all the raw data and all the protein-protein interaction and the graph modeling, graph model descriptors as supplementary figures. And if some of you wants to pursue the drug discovery, please feel to do that. And with this, I would like to acknowledge all my mentors and the colleagues who've been very helpful in this project, and all my lab members who've been working on several of this drug discovery and computational projects, and all my research collaborators inside UMS and outside of UMS who've been very helpful in providing samples and collaborating in mouse models and other aspects of the research. And definitely, I would like to thank this funding support, without which it would have not been possible. So luckily, we are nicely funded by two NIH R01 and program project grant. And I would like to thank the Inglewood Foundation for funding my assistant professor support, and the Department of Veterans Affairs for our VA Merit Grant, and the Reese Lab, and all our and the GPU computing. So this is the SimLab that we recently inaugurated for doing the high performance computing and GPU research. And definitely I would like to thank UMS for our space. So that, and this is our group on the program project group that working on this research. And I would like to take any questions if you have. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, BMS, for a wonderful talk. So here we have questions from our audience. So the first question is, IDPs can have different conformations every time during molecular simulations. So how can we select a particular conformation for further analysis?
Okay, very interesting question. Yes, so that's why what we did is, we did this simulations for multiple times, like the same surf tools, I did it for 4 to 5 times. But there is one catch here. IDPs on their own takes multiple conformation, but when they interact with another protein, then that conformation change, that drastic conformational change will be less. So we took all possible conformations from the SURF2, and then we did the screening. So the topmost compounds that I got from the screen, so I searched against, I took almost 50 different conformations from the SURF2. And the criteria that I gave is my drugs has to bind to almost all those conformation. So if any problem is there, at least some will definitely hit. And also based, I did not really put the drug only to the SURF2. I really did against that protein-protein interaction pair. Yes. And there is always a problem in that. So that's one of the major trouble in IDPs.
Okay, that's interesting. And then the next question is, can the graphical data be analyzed using deep neuronal networks? Is it possible to use this graphical data for deep neuronal networks?
Yes. But there is one catch there. I am not really sure about deep learning. I have never done deep learning, which I'm trying to do it. But As far as I know, deep learning needs a lot of data set. For example, right now we had only 50 to 60 protein knockdowns. So I'm not sure, but what I learned from my friends is like we need more, like thousands of data points to really do the deep learning, but something that we need to really work on it.
Yes, fine. So does knock in and out in unknown proteins can cause mutations in some cases?
Like knockdown of one protein, if I understood the question, so while we are doing a knockdown of one protein, will it cause mutation of another protein? Is that what the question is?
The question they are asking is whether knock in and knock out, does knock in and knock out in unknown proteins. So if you are knocking in or knocking out for an unknown protein, whether it will cause us any mutation?
No, I don't think so, because we definitely won't do for unknown proteins. Definitely, we know what this protein is, but if you knock down that particular protein, I'm not sure whether that really takes a mutation of another protein. Definitely, I don't think so.
Fine. So how to get to know about the AA interactions when protein-protein interactions happen?
Amino. So AA means like
amino acids.
Amino acid interaction of
protein-protein interaction.
Yes, this if you use a cross-linking method, that will tell you. Like the raw data from this mass spectrometry will. You have to use the software called X-Link Identifier, which I can actually send it to Dr. Parasuram. That if somebody wants, you can also email me. I can send you the link for the software. So that if you supply this raw data from the mass spectrometry after doing the click chemistry, then that will give you the protein-protein pairs or the amino acid pairs in the data.
The peptide. Fine. So how does the MD simulations help to understand the protein-protein interaction? Is it possible to find any findings from the MD simulations for protein-protein interaction?
Yes, we can. If you don't have a click chemistry or anything, then that is a predictive method, but you can still do that. So if you have a good crystal structure or NMR structure to begin with, then you can first do the protein-protein docking. And then use the complex, and then you can do some long-run simulations, probably in a microsecond scale. That would tell you the protein-protein interactions, actually, predict.
Fine. And then the next question is, will targeting the interactions of the hub protein to the hub connector be a good idea for going for a lead search?
Yes, you can. It depends on what is the hub protein. Definitely hub protein and hub connector both can be a good target, but it depends on what is the hub protein is, whether it is accessible by the drug. Then yes, it is doable. Hub protein is targeting a hub protein is a very good strategy, and also hub connector is somewhat like maybe error prone or error free, I would say, if you use hub connector.
Fine. So two more questions. Uh-huh. So is CRISPR used for knockdown instead of RNA?
Yes, you can. But knockdown is pretty simple than CRISPR. When you want to really screen a big large amount of data set, but yeah, CRISPR can be doable. But knockdown is easier than CRISPR, because usually CRISPR we use to do knock-in. Like if you want to really do a point mutation, or if you want to do that alanine scanning, or those CRISPR would be useful for knockdown. Even in cell culture, knockdown is pretty simple. But if you are going for mouse or something, then probably maybe CRISPR would be the way to go.
That's cool. Are K-means clustering algorithms? K-means clustering algorithms useful to analyze the data further after graph modeling?
K-means cluster. Yes. Actually, that is a very important terminology. The K-means clustering is very important to see where your clusters. I think one of the descriptors that we used is also K-means, I believe. And that gives you exactly where the hub is and how tightly is the hub connected. Yes.
Okay, fine. And then the next question is, any specific AA software is available apart from graph modeling for screening pharmacodynamic and PK of phytomolecules or any constituents? Is there any software like available for artificial intelligence? How we are using for docking, no? Like a Schrodinger is available, AutoDock is available, like that, any specific softwares?
No. For AI based protein-protein interaction, right?
Mm-hmm.
No, I think I've recently seen a paper like that, but I'm not sure whether it is for protein-protein. I think it is for protein-drug. They have AI that can predict, but I'm not sure about protein-protein interaction.
Fine. So how do you decide a particular spectroscopy or microscopy for a particular experiment?
Oh, wow, that's a very interesting question. Okay. But actually, I don't know really. We use the Orbitrap and the fusion for the normal proteomics, the high sensitive proteomics, and for crosslinker, I think it is all any high sensitive spectrometry should be fine. I'm not really sure about this mass spec area actually.
Fine. Cool. So one of the last question, what is G5 software? And then they are asking, can you suggest for new emerging researcher to use G5?
G5 is a good one because I first used Cytoscape, and a lot of my friends are using Cytoscape. But then I wanted to do a lot of this descriptors to create. So I'm not sure how to do that in Cytoscape, and then I did it in G5. And I think G5 is really a better place to start because this is the first work that I did in graph modeling, and it worked perfectly fine for me, the G5.
Cool. So Dr. BMS, thank you so much for your wonderful presentation and sharing your knowledge, what you have learned, what you have experienced in artificial intelligence, as well as your drug discovery things.
Thank you.
Balasubramaniam, sir.
Yes.
There is one more question someone asked. Do you think that the synaptic complexity of C. elegans is strong enough to mimic the Alzheimer's disease pathophysiology of Homo sapiens to be served as an excellent model for degenerative neuro disorders? Or you choose it only due to its short lifespan?
No. It doesn't have a brain for sure. But their neural pattern is, we can do the synapse, especially the question they asked with the synapse. Yes, because the models that we are using has a aggregation in their neurons, in their neural pattern. So when they have more aggregates, it mimics the Alzheimer's pathology. For example, the chemotaxis is a behavior where it gets attracted towards the chemoattractor. So once you have so much of aggregation, it forgets where it's going. So it's wandered around the plate. So that exactly mimics the Alzheimer's. So that is one of the cool feature in C. elegans, why we are using that in the AD research or the neurodegenerative, because we cannot use for some other purpose, but for AD, it's an excellent model to begin with, I would say.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yes, fine. Thank you, Dr. BMS.
Thank you so much.